Greetings, everyone, and welcome to In Your District. My name is Donna Reed, and I'm honored and proud to represent District 5, Reading's Great Northwest. Today, we have with us a very important person and part of District 5 of Reading's Great Northwest. This is Reverend Mary Wolfe. Mary and her congregation at Hope Lutheran Church are really pillars of Northwest Reading and have been beyond wonderful in bringing the community together, uniting the community, making everyone understand how important they are to the fabric of a community, because if we don't view ourselves and understand that we are each other's neighbors, we're each other's friends, we are each other's advocates, we don't have much of a community. And I think we have a pretty darn good one in Northwest Reading. And Mary, you and your congregation and the folks who support the congregation have been fabulous in working with our community. So welcome, it's good to see you.
Thank you.
I know you were very busy today at the cafe working and serving and cooking, I'm assuming.
Cooking, washing dishes, sweeping floors, yeah.
And you still look relaxed, so there you go. She has incredible amounts of energy, so maybe it rubs off. So anyhow, Mary, thank you for taking the time to come here and to talk a little bit about the church, about the church congregation, about your outreach efforts, and about the community of the greater Northwest Reading, the interior part of Northwest Reading, really around the 600 block of Front Street and Greenwich Lawn up to Windsor and that whole neighborhood, which is a really good neighborhood. So thank you again for being here. And let's talk a little bit. How long have you been at Hope Lutheran now?
Had the honor of serving at Hope as the called pastor for 15 years, but for about 5 years before that, I was a student there for a while and did some volunteer work. So I've really been with that congregation for 20 years.
And you've really helped put Hope on a map, the documentary. How many years ago was that now?
That was in 2012.
Is that how, 10 years ago?
It was.
And just synopsize that documentary.
Sure, that was the year that Reading was declared the poorest city in the country, and some people in New York that we had some connections with decided to come and do something in Reading, a documentary that would be aired on CBS on Christmas Eve, because they do an hour long every year, like public service Christmas program. And it was called Faces of Hope. And it didn't just focus on our congregation, but it was hope in the middle of what was then a really bad recession. And we interviewed, or they interviewed, lots of people from the neighborhood, some congregation members, some not, about where they find hope in these tough times. And then it culminated in readings and music from four different musical groups from the city of Reading, and I got to preach on television for 5 million people.
So. You weren't nervous at all.
Oh, no, not at all. And then it aired at 11 o'clock on Christmas Eve.
How wonderful. I remember everyone being so excited about it, and it's hard for me to imagine that was 10 years ago now. Mm-hmm. Wow, yeah. Time flies.
Yeah.
But in that time, all the good things you guys have done. So talk a little bit, and you want to start a little bit, and Mary's brought some images along here to show us. About you want to start off a little bit with the food pantry that you do and your community meals.
Yeah, sure. This is what Hope Lutheran Church itself looks like, the corner of Front and Green, which we're sort of I think we symbolize stability in that neighborhood.
Absolutely.
And we have been trusted partners since long before I came. The congregation helped out in the neighborhood, and when I first got there. Well, this is downstairs. We have a community meal on Tuesdays, but this is the room where we used to have our food pantry. We are no longer able to have it indoors starting during the pandemic.
That's right. That's right. So you do it outdoors now, correct?
Yes, we do. This is one of our lovely guests. She is a volunteer at the food pantry. And this is what it looks like on any given second or fourth Tuesday of the month. We serve approximately 200 families each time, and we learned from Jay Worrell of the food bank that we served more food last year than any other food pantry in all of Berks or Schuylkill counties that are serviced by the Helping Harvest Food
Bank.
That's
right, and I think our late council president was out there with you with accommodation. Jeff, I remembered him telling me that was he was so proud he was able to do that commendation because he grew up partially in that area.
Right.
And that meant so much
to
him.
He went to Boy Scouts at Hope Lutheran
Church.
That's
right. It meant so much to him, and we miss him terribly, but I'm glad he was able to do that.
Yeah, I am too, and volunteers were really honored by that commendation.
Great guy.
So that's what the crazy food pantry looks like. Those are some of our happy clients.
Very good. Like to see smiles.
But so we went from the food pantry, which we serve at the food pantry. We serve people. Currently, it's bags and boxes of food that we have packaged, because before the pandemic, we were serving about 70 families every other week, and we were able to have people come in and do client choice.
Mm-hmm.
But
I remember that in the
church, we loved, but we would have to be able to have a full-time pantry coordinator to be able to serve 250 families that way.
And that's an interesting uptick and a telling uptick, because we've seen it throughout the country and certainly here in the city.
The very first pantry after the governor had shut things down, we jumped from 70 families to over 200.
Wow.
The very first
one. That's incredible.
And it has held
steady.
Were
you prepared for that?
We were prepared for more. I think as we saw the lines forming, we just kind of cut back on what we could give. So we fortunately have never had to turn anyone away without food.
That's wonderful. It's a real blessing.
It's like the loaves and fishes, you know?
Yeah.
Like
there's
always enough no matter what you plan for. That works really well.
Very cool. Very cool.
Well, then in addition to the pantry ministry, we also have a community meal. You saw the one picture inside the room on Tuesday evenings. And we serve currently about 100 to-go meals. We used to be able to sit together and form community inside. We had a worship service that followed the meal. It wasn't a requirement for the meal. But then during the pandemic, because the cafe, which I'll talk about next, couldn't open, we had some staff, and they partnered with the volunteers from the church that did the community meal, and then began to serve takeout meals from the parking lot. And we were serving 200 meals every Tuesday and Thursday for a year. Which was huge. And we picked Tuesday and Thursday because the schools were giving out food Monday and Wednesday. And so we were hoping to fill
a need
for the families. But that meal always felt a little bit like a soup kitchen to me. You know, people got in line. There were rarely any choices, maybe two different vegetables. But in general, everybody got the same thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they...
Pardon me. She's always on call.
Pardon me.
That's okay.
So we decided that we wanted to do something that would be better at building community, that just seeing our neighbors and getting to know them as they pass through a line wasn't enough. The church owns an end-of-the-row home across the street on West Greenwich Street, adjacent to our parking lot.
Was that once the minister's house? Was that once the...
No, that was purchased with some money that the church had received in an endowment.
Okay.
And they used to use it for various meetings and things,
but then
we had given it over to...
It was never the rectory then.
No. Family Promise used
it as the day center for years.
When they first started.
I forgot about that. That's right.
And then we used it very rarely after that, and it was in pretty rough shape by the time we decided to do something with it. So around 2012, when we did that documentary, is when I was beginning to foment this idea of a pay what you can community cafe. And our very first grant came as a result of that documentary.
How wonderful.
They gave out some...
Everything comes together.
It really does. They gave out some community grants. I guess people had applied, and we were at the Miller Center, and they had the premiere showing of the documentary, and they were giving out grants, and everybody's getting all this money. And I'm thinking, well, you know, we at least got the TV show. But they saved mine for last, and I got to get up and receive.
Oh, how fabulous.
It was really a wonderful moment and very encouraging. And so once we had that first little bit of seed money in the bank, we began to really dream about what this could be. I'll show you what the cafe...
Do you want to talk about the name of the cafe?
I sure will.
Okay.
So here is our logo. This pay what you can community cafe is called Café Esperanza. Esperanza is the Spanish word for hope, and our neighborhood is probably at least 60% Spanish speaking, mm-hmm. at least as you know, the children mostly speak English, but almost everyone speaks some Spanish mm-hmm. in the neighborhood. And so we thought that was appropriate to try to reach out to our neighbors. But it means hope, which I always thought was a great name for a church,
it's
too.
It's perfect. It's perfect. Yeah. It can be better.
And our logo was created by a wonderful local artist by the name of Yenna Hill. And she donated that artwork to us from the goodness of her heart. As you can see, the logo has a picture of the pagoda.
Yeah, the image of a pagoda, mm-hmm. yeah, absolutely.
But it's very stylized, and mm-hmm. you can see that it shows the diversity mm-hmm. of the city. So there's mm-hmm. all different patterns.
And I love the dandelion at the top. That has to be about my favorite part of it, I think.
Well, yeah, because the dandelion is this really useful, sturdy plant. You can't kill it. I mean, mm-hmm. you probably have tried, but you can't. and we shouldn't, because it provides early food for the bees.
Mm-hmm. And for people.
That's true.
If you're Pennsylvania Dutch, you do the dandelion.
Absolutely, I love it.
With the dressing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and you can make dandelion wine. You can use the roots for various medicinal purposes.
I wouldn't recommend your dandelion wine. I love wine, but have you ever tried it?
I haven't.
Do yourself a favor. Keep with the other parts of it. The dandelion greens are fabulous. And of course, like as you're saying, the flowers for the honeybees.
Mm-hmm. Well, and so at the top, there's the bud, which kind of shows the potential. There's the flower, which is beautiful. And then I like to think of the seeds as seeds of hope going out from the city, out from the cafe.
Very nice.
To the neighborhood.
Very nice. And you even have the roots in there, too.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
The roots are there. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's very, very inventive and very imaginative.
So this is what the cafe looks inside. This is before we put our menu. Our menu items are listed up on the board, but we hadn't added any yet. So mm-hmm. this was right before we opened. Mm-hmm. That's what the space looks like. That's my daughter, Emily, who's the executive director.
She does a great job with it. Great job with it.
It's been a project of the heart for both mm-hmm. of us.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And you get, what's so great is you get the family feel. You feel so welcome when you walk in there. And I've been in there many times in the neighborhood, the community, folks from outside the community. Mm-hmm. You guys have done a great job.
Well, thank you. The first thing you'd see is the sign that says Abierto. On the other side, it says smiling faces and great food. this is one of our volunteers, Nicole, who does our lettering for us and puts the menu up on the board. We have people from all over that have contributed to this cafe. It could never have happened without the talents and skills and generosity of the whole community. It took 10 years for, or almost 10 years for us to open. And the pandemic delayed things so many roadblocks.
There were
roadblocks.
So many things that you dealt with.
Mm-hmm. But we're really grateful to the City of Reading, to the Zoning Board, to the, you know, all the people in PMI and codes, and mm-hmm. like everybody was encouraging of us and tried to help us to make this all mm-hmm. come about. Mm-hmm. This is a picture of our back to school party from last Friday.
Very nice. I didn't make it there because I was with my grandson doing some other things, but it looked great.
It was fabulous. We had a wonderful time. We had hot dogs and ice cream cones and snacks.
Can't go wrong
and
with that.
Kids got books and socks and colored pencils and
very
things.
Nice. Very nice.
And this is one of the aspects of our cafe that I really like. People can donate to us. Each wooden nickel costs $10. Mm-hmm. And then they can either take them along, and if they see someone that says, I'm hungry, they can give them a token, and it has the address on, and they can come
a
meal. Or sometimes people just give us the $10 and we keep them, and then when someone comes in
and
is unable to pay.
Yeah, that way it's there for the person.
Right, too. Right. So the way it works is that people can order anything they want on the menu. Our food is as organic, local, and seasonal as possible. Mm-hmm. For instance, we buy our meat for our sandwiches from Dunder and Heister, the local butcher, mm-hmm. that and they source their food from local farms that mm-hmm. are organic and also humane in their treatment of their animals. And we get our milk from a local dairy, and we get goat's cheese from another local dairy.
Very cool.
So we're trying to support the community businesses.
And the produce,
and
local.
The produce, right? Yeah, B&H and Rodale and Kumakamala Ashram. People
bring, nice.
Yeah, bring us piles of produce.
And perfect, perfect. And I've
really
seen outside, I've seen you have tomatoes and squash right along the intersection
right.
there where
right, if it's more than we can
pick
use.
Them up, mm-hmm. which is nice.
Yeah, we put out a table market free. Mm-hmm. And the other day I had a mountain of okra and did not know what to do with it. And I put it out in small bags thinking, oh, I hope somebody knows what to do with it. And sure enough, by the next day it was gone. So
fabulous.
It found
fabulous.
A home.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good.
So that it's the end of these pictures.
Okay. And we thought we'd talk a little bit about, well, do you want to mention anything else about the cafe, any upcoming events with the cafe?
Well, yeah, I don't have a calendar date yet. We're hoping to hold a fundraiser this fall mm-hmm. because the cafe needs to function mainly by mm-hmm. Grants and fundraising and contributions from local churches mm-hmm. and different organizations. So hopefully later this fall there will be a fundraising gala that we'll be inviting folks to come to. That will also be a suggested donation, a pay mm-hmm. what you can mm-hmm. gala, so that everyone
will
can
be
contribute.
On site, or will you be somewhere else?
We're hoping to be at the Distillery Guild.
Oh, very nice, up just right up the street.
Right.
That would be great. That's a beautiful.
It is beautiful.
That's a really interesting rehab of an existing property.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And they've done a great job with that.
Yeah,
John Weidenhammer and everyone. Very
mm-hmm.
nice.
And I think the main thing about the cafe is that what we're really trying to do is break down barriers between people who are different from each other, mm-hmm. who wouldn't necessarily have an opportunity to meet each other. We have people from SAM that come in and meet with their clients there. It's a place where they don't have to worry about not being able to buy their client lunch mm-hmm. Because we're happy, you know, for anyone
sure.
to eat. We're reaching out lately. Our latest emphasis is going to be reaching out to college students because I know that so many college students are food insecure. And so we have some posters to go up at the various colleges, and we're trying to get in touch with guidance counselors and advisors and people who would know who might really need a place to come. And we encourage people to volunteer with us also. So
very cool.
If they want, you know, if anyone wants to come and volunteer for a few hours and eat a good meal at the end of your mm-hmm. shift, I mean, you can come in and eat a good meal without volunteering, too, but it's a fun
and
experience.
You would take those of us who aren't good cooks.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, we could wash dishes or
oh,
something.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. Or you can. Anybody can put a sandwich together, you know, Donna.
You haven't eaten my cooking, have you? But, no, that's great because there's so many people that live within walking distance of there, mm-hmm. and I think there's a lot of folks like myself who are, I'd like to think, younger retirees. Never think of your chronological age.
Right.
But who really want something to do, something that they feel is purposeful.
Mm-hmm.
And this, if anything I've seen in the city of Reading is purposeful, this is. And it's enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
So you're doing something that's important for the community and social and interactive mm-hmm. and interesting people. I've not yet gone near that I haven't talked to someone interesting.
Right. And people that you probably never would have met otherwise.
Right, exactly. And mm-hmm. and some people that I had not expected to see. If you remember Dr. Fair, Reverend Dr. Fair from Alice's,
mm-hmm.
his widow was in there one day eating, and
yes.
we reconnected, and then I reconnected with another friend, and we all had lunch somewhere else another day. So those are the kind of interesting things, meeting new people and meeting people who are new to the neighborhood, but sometimes reestablishing old friendships or old acquaintances, and isn't that what the perfect eatery is?
Yes, I like to think so. We also have people that come in, lots of people that live outdoors, and they'll come in and charge their phones and either warm up if it's cold outside or cool off if
it's
hot,
which we've had enough of that in August.
Yes, we sure have. And they can get a good breakfast. Sometimes they'll even stay and have a nice lunch.
Oh, how nice. How nice.
We have lots of reading material. People can take books mm-hmm. with them if they like, and magazines.
And you accept those if people have magazines and books. You would accept them as part of like a little free library
yep,
exchange.
That's, mm-hmm.
So that's a great,
yeah.
great option as well.
Mm-hmm.
And they can be any kind of books.
Any kind of books, yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Fiction, nonfiction.
Sure.
Run
yeah.
a gamut.
Yep.
Good. I think you see more of that popping up all over the place, which is really great because I love to do that. I love to get a book and take it and read it and go to Goodwill and take it back to Goodwill or Op Shop or something.
Right.
And I think it's really great when you see these small things in different places. And yours is a perfect place because maybe somebody will sit there and read a book and somebody else will say, I read that book. And you have a little book club.
Another conversation, yeah.
You have a little book club happening.
I love that idea.
So that's great. Yeah. That's great. So do you have any other plans for the building going forward? I mean, you have the cafe pretty established now. You have a beautiful first room, then you have the second room, then you have the kitchen. So there's a decent amount of space to sit and interact.
Well, we do. So the second and third floors, the second floor is getting to be in much better shape because we have some really dedicated volunteers that have been cleaning it out and fixing it up. We still need a fair amount of work up there, but there are two big rooms, one in the front. Mm-hmm. That's a big, beautiful room that we hope to set up.
Bay windows.
Yeah.
Those are great.
They are. They really are. And we're hoping to put a conference table there and make that available for people to have meetings. We already have a smart TV for the wall.
Oh, fabulous.
So
fabulous.
That people can hook up their PowerPoints.
Very good.
And then the second room we hope to make into a quiet space with a sofa and a coffee table, and then there'll be counters around two walls with outlets where people can bring their laptop and work. We might even provide one PC there and a printer, because a lot of people in the neighborhood need a place to go print documents or look things up and then have that available to them.
Oh, that's great. Very good.
And we have a lot of students already that come and work there. Mm-hmm. And young professionals that have, been coming in, getting their coffee and working. But sometimes it gets really loud downstairs.
Mm-hmm. So they have a quiet place. That gives a little bit more respite. I might consider that when I'm writing my next magazine article.
Awesome.
Or as we're working on the 275th book for the city of Reading, maybe we'll get some folks in there working on that.
Nice.
So that'd be great. So that's coming along. You think maybe by the winter that'll be ready, or
it depends on whether we are able to secure the grants that I've applied
to go forward.
We are always operating on a frayed shoestring.
So if anybody is out there listening and has either the capability of helping or monetarily helping, just get in touch with Café Esperanza and Mary.
Yeah, any electricians and plumbers.
We need
those kind of workers too.
Okay. So. Okay. We'll see if we can reach out to some of them out there. Of course, they're probably so busy right now. Everybody seems now that things are getting back to normal to being working at full tilt, which is good.
It is good.
It's good.
We celebrate that.
That's good. So you have a garden yet as well, and I know our time is starting to diminish here, but tell us a little bit about the garden, the challenges. There's been many challenges with that garden, as I recall.
Oh, yeah.
And many opportunities. Always there's an opportunity when there's a challenge, right?
Yes. So the garden... Sorry.
Oh, that's okay.
The Garden of Hope is catacorner across the street from the church building.
So the address is 622, 624?
626, 628.
Okay. Yep. I was close.
And it was, first, when I first started there, it was a duplex that the roof was caving in, the porch was falling off.
I remember that.
It was very dangerous.
And that was on our blighted property list. Mm-hmm. And you're a member of that committee.
I
used to be, but I guess, who's on with you now? Chris? Johanny.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. So that's how I got involved in that, because I went to the mayor to talk about how do we get rid of properties like
and
this.
And I remember that being your council member. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So he said, well, there's this new committee we're forming. I'll put you on it. Mm-hmm. And they had already designated that building for demolition.
Yeah.
So first one side came down.
It was a health hazard,
Oh, it was.
For the kids.
And a fire hazard,
safety.
Too.
Yeah.
And then the second half came down and it took years. And then finally, we were able to purchase one half from the county repository for a song. Mm-hmm. The second half cost us a pretty penny. The other owner, I guess,
just didn't want to give it up.
Hanging on.
Yeah. So, that happens frequently.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
But we managed. We got it, and then it.
So now you have a garden that's.
Yep. Yeah. It took years to get rid of all the abandoned cars, but with the help of other partners, we have a beautiful.
And
garden.
We have a gated. It's gated now, correct?
No. It's no. You can't pull in. You can't park there. It's got a chain across.
Okay.
But it's open, and we invite the neighbors to pick.
Gated from cars.
Oh yes, from cars.
Yeah. Not from people.
No. Yeah, anybody can come in. The kids play in the grassy area,
and we
grow lots of good vegetables for folks.
Very good. And it's a that spot actually was years ago a tragic spot because of that little boy who was on a roof and paddled off. So it's nice to see something hopeful and beautiful there. Hopefully people treasure their kids.
Right, and it's for the kids.
So. Absolutely, absolutely. Ugh, there are things you remember you'd rather forget.
Right.
And certainly it would be remiss not to discuss it. We've had some challenges in that block recently. Mm-hmm. We had one shooting earlier this summer, and then we recently had a domestic that resulted in a shooting death.
Yes.
And we're not going to go into any details about any of them, but mm-hmm. what do you say to people? I mean, obviously I tended to come upon the one that was I'm not going to say just a shooting, but one that was fortunately not a fatal. And I talked to people in the neighborhood because I was going home and just sort of stopped and talked to people. And I just got the impression, and I didn't say I'm your council person or anything. I just simply talked to people. People, overwhelmingly, people are wonderful. And they want everything that we all want. Safety, the young kids. I was talking to some of the high school kids. They said, we just want to live. We just want to live. What do you say to your congregants, to the neighbors? Because certainly these conversations come up to you.
They do. I even had to do one of the funerals for one of the people that was shot neighborhood.
That's right.
We just talk about how we have to all be in this together. We have to all be watching out for each other. It's when people are isolated that things go haywire. That's why I think the pandemic,
I was going to ask you, do you think, from your perspective, has that increased these kind of problems between people, these kind of irritants or whatever you want to call them?
I believe it has because I think people are so stressed. You know, I mean, maybe they're coming out of it a little bit now, although with the case counts, maybe we're being premature and coming out, you know, and being together more. But people need people, and young people really need to be with other young people, and not being in school, or not even being able to further their lives, mm-hmm. to seek out classes at RAC or get a good job, you know, make some money, mm-hmm. all the things that you expect to be able to do when you're in your late teens and early 20s, and it all kind of ground to a halt.
And it just stopped for a while, like you're saying, it just stopped, and now it's the catch up of that career path or that life path or the friends or whatever. Mm-hmm. And part of this, and I know it's been discussed, and that oftentimes, especially if there's domestic issues, sometimes there's a mental health component to it. Mm-hmm. What do you say to folks when you talk to people, family members, with friends who are sort of at their wits' end? How do you refer them to people that can help them? Because there's a network of, Reading is fabulous, there's a network of organizations.
There are many, many organizations. Sometimes it's through the Office of Aging, you know, mm-hmm. depending on who mm-hmm. the person is. If it's a student, I usually ask them to please talk to their guidance counselor, or I'll, you know, have their parents recommend that they speak to their guidance counselor. A lot of times people are really reticent to get counseling. There still is a stigma.
Yes, which is unfortunate.
I'm not a therapist. You know, people will come to me and say, I need counseling.
But you're a good conduit, as are many folks in your profession, who can say, here's your next step, here's, I understand, here's your next step. And I think that compassion, that sense of someone cares enough to lock eyes and talk, and that, I just think there can't be enough said for that. And I appreciate everything you and your colleagues do, Pastor Bruce in my neighborhood, mm-hmm. everybody throughout the city of every faith.
People need somebody to walk with them sometimes
Absolutely.
Through their hard times. And the ministry of presence, we call it, just to be mm-hmm. there. And that's why it's so important for the cafe and for the congregation to be stable, mm-hmm. To say that we're not just going to open up for a little while, have a couple of events, and close. We're here for
the
long haul. And you can come in every day if you need to and sit, and somebody will greet you and talk to you and, you know, give you something good to eat. And walk with
and
you.
Breaking bread together, isn't that the ultimate fellowship fellowship?
Yeah, it is, absolutely.
Well, I guess our time is drawing to a close, so thank you, Mary. Thank you for taking the time to be here. Thanks for everything you do. Thanks for the hope you're giving.
Thank you.
Literal form and edible form to the neighborhood of Northwest Reading. I think we have a fabulous community out there, and It's you've only made it better. So
thank you. It's been an honor to be here.
We invite everybody to come on and see us and see why we think Northwest Reading's a great place to be and to do pretty much everything.
Absolutely.
So, okay, happy Labor Day weekend, everybody. Come visit the 5th District. Come visit the city of Reading. Come visit beautiful downtown Reading, where we're sitting right now, Alvernia, BCTV. Life is good. It's getting better. Have a good day.